us, there are a few holidays that bring nostalgia as Pentecost will be, because there was such a glory days, you know, 3,000 saved in one day, miracles and miraculous listening and all of this. But if this is all that Pentecost is to us today, a nostalgic remembrance of the day, it's not really the point, because it will harden us in the long run. It will numb us to the activities of God, to what God wants to do. You know, God has not changed his purpose. What is the purpose of God? Redeem, save the world. It is blessing the world, but he wants to do it right now. And that's why the Holy Spirit needs, you know, to give us a Pentecost from generation to generation. It is. It makes me think a bit like communion. Why do we take communion every day? How do we take communion? We look back to in the past to what Jesus Christ has done. We remember him. But the intended effect of taking communions while thinking of the past is for the present. It is to revive our spiritual relationship with Jesus Christ right now. You understand what I'm saying? We remember the past, but it is for the now that we are doing it. So Pentecost should be something like this. It should prompt us to action. It is to prepare ourselves for God's actions right here, right now, in our city, in our church, in our generation. There is a quiz. If maybe you are wondering, like maybe you're running low on power of God, a bit like drifting away and losing some sense of the full meaning of the abundant life that Jesus Christ. Maybe you're running low on power. So we have here Wesley's self-examination quiz that is maybe to help you to take a test for yourself. Look at these questions. And there are more questions, but I just took a few of them to bring us along and thinking. Am I self-conscious, self-pitying, self-justifying, always trying to excuse ourselves and debate? Am I a slave to dress, friends, Facebook, work, habits, video games? Am I a slave of that? Is it too excessive in my life? Do I give the Bible time to speak to me every day? When did I last speak to someone else of my faith? Do I pray about the money I spend? Well, I think not so many of us are doing that. Do you pray about the money you spend? Do I get to bed on time and get up on time? How do I spend my spare time? Do I insist upon doing something about which my conscience is uneasy? I know I shouldn't really be doing this, but it's like I'm doing it anyway. Am I jealous, impure, critical, irritable, touchy, distrustful? Oh, because these are not in line with the fruit of the Spirit producing. So what of these questions indicates to you when you take it for yourself? It's like, you know, Pentecost should not be about the past, but we should anticipate and make sense of God's ongoing activities right now. Find out our role. Are we active? Do we recognize God's activities in our lives right now? Is God active in me? Is it clear? Is it evident to other people? I read an article from a pastor about what happened in their church. And he says a week before Pentecost, they had what they call a commitment Sunday, a little bit like these cards. People came they were invited to commit for whatever things they were doing. And the congregation responded in an extraordinary way. And the following week was Pentecost Sunday. So during his sermon, he made a remark, and he said, I have seen Pentecost happen on this last week commitment Sunday. I have seen Pentecost happen. But when he said that, it was just like a minor point. It was not meant to be like a big point of his sermon. But instead, he said, more people commented on that single line that on anything I preach in quite for quite some time. They were touched when he said that. You know why? Because the most frequent remark was to the pastors, "You help me experience Pentecost as something that is happening today, not long ago." So that's the phrase that he says and is speaking. When he connected that phrase to something that happened the week before in their church, people made a connection with the Holy Spirit. They realized that the Holy Spirit had done something unique, had done something big, powerful the week before. So in fact, this was nothing like so high as the original Pentecost Sunday. But the point was that they had recognized God's activities that had been at work in them and through them that week when God visited their church on that Sunday. By that is, the details of what happened is not really important. Like we cannot compare to the 3,000 on the Pentecost day. But the point is, what was important is what that they recognized and experienced the active God at work through them at this moment. So what about you this morning? Do you recognize the activity of the Holy Spirit in your life? Is there more activity of the Holy Spirit in your life now? Is it growing? Is it abundant? Or has it been vanishing, the activities of the Holy Spirit in your life? This is important. We need to check that out. And that's why to celebrate or commemorate certain events like Pentecost, it's important. At Easter, we review our doctrines, our faith on the resurrections. At Christmas, we review our faith on the miraculous birth of Jesus Christ and His coming and His purpose. So on Pentecost, we review, we do some checkup of ourselves. So if the Holy Spirit's activities are not as much, or is it been vanishing of your life, or less in your life, what are you going to do about it? Are you just going to go on? Careless, ignore it, and just go on? If you do, then it will harden your heart. It will make you less, even less sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You will lose your connection with the Holy Spirit. So today, you have the opportunity to experience Pentecost as something that is happening today. And you should do that. In Acts chapter 2, verse 39, the next slide, here you read that God's promise, or the gifts of the Holy Spirit, that promise that God has made, was made to you and to your children and to all who are far away, all whom the Lord our God calls to Himself. The gifts of the Holy Spirit is an absolute essential reality for each generation. You, your children. Your children are going to lead the church. They are going to be the deacon. They are going to be, you know, the evangelist and the pastors. Where are they? How are they seeing the church and everything? What about your children? If you are parents tonight, this morning, sorry, maybe my mind is like tonight. What about your children? Have they received the Holy Spirit's baptism as children? Do you know about the Holy Spirit? Do they know about the Holy Spirit, your children? This is for them as well, that the Lord has given them this promise. And I want to, you know, remember last week I was looking through church history, so I want to do it a bit quickly again today in line of what I'm talking. In church history, all of the great reforms and all of the great reforms and revivals are something that the Holy Spirit have done. It shows the ongoing activities from God. Because you have seen last week, we looked at some of the early reformers, or before the church reformation, Wycliffe, Tyndale, what they have done. And the Holy Spirit, it was the Holy Spirit that was working in them. So today I want to look a little bit later in history. So when men and women wants to return to God in their generation, there is an ongoing activity of the Holy Spirit for them and empowerment sacrament of the Holy Spirit. Even Martin Luther, the great theologian of 1859 in Germany, there's a registry of church history written by German historian R. Kunze, and he says, Luther was easily the greatest evangelical man after the apostles, full of inner love, hasty in deed, deep in thinking, cunning and powerful in speech, uncompromising, prophet and evangelist. And look at what it says of him, that I didn't know that. Speaker in tongues, an interpreter in one person, equipped with all the gifts of grace, a light and pillar of the church. This is the comments of this German historian about Martin Luther. And there are many more of that. One of them that I want to draw your attention to is John Wesley, who brought the greatest revival in England. At the same time in France, it was another kind of revolution. Their heads were being cut and there was a lot of trouble. But in Germany, when people were drunk and there was a very tough time, a lot of poverty, a lot of injustice in the country, a lot of trouble, John and his brother Charles Wesley received something from the Holy Spirit. John Wesley had contacts with the Moravian believers from Switzerland, and they became open to the charismatic gifts of God. And one of Wesley's most trusted preachers and friends, Thomas Wash, recorded the following charismatic experience. This morning, the Lord gave me a language that I knew not of, raising my soul to him in a wonderful manner. And it is clear through the writing, because Wesley wrote a lot, he recorded a lot of things. Wesley made it clear that he believed in the continuance of tongues and other gifts of the Holy Spirit referred to in the Bible. In one of his sermons, The More Excellent Way, Wesley says that Paul, the Apostle Paul, has been speaking of the ordinary gifts of the Holy Ghost, such as healing of the sick, prophesying, the proper sense of the word, speaking with strange tongues, such as the speaker had never learned, and the miraculous interpretation of the tongues. And he says, there is nothing either in the Old Testament or the New Testament that teach that miracles were to be confined to the limit of the apostolic or the post-apostolic era of the church. In other words, it's for every generation. And Wesley had the deepest convictions that the Lord still does miracles in modern times. So that is a man that lives in the 1700. The other one, Martin Luther, was in the 1500. Now we're talking 1700. If you go a little bit in the 1800, you have Charles Finney, which is one of the greatest revivalists in the U.S. And shortly after Finney's conversion, he was waiting on the Lord, asking for spiritual enablement when he was mightily moved upon by the Lord. And his autobiography, Finney refers to this experience as the baptism, Charles Finney, next one, follow with me, baptism of the Holy Spirit, and described the occasion as follows. I wept aloud with joy and love, and literally roared out the unutterable gushings of my souls. I was powerfully converted on the morning of the month of October 1822. In the evening of the same day, I received overwhelming baptisms of the Holy Ghost that went through me, as it seems to me, body and soul. I immediately found myself endued with such power from on high that a few words dropped here and there to individuals were the means of their immediate conversion. And that is what followed is baptism of the Holy Spirit. Charles Finney was going everywhere in manufacturers on the street. People would stop working and people would get saved. Just with a few words of his mouth, there was such an anointing upon him. And this experience of the anointing was to the drive for Finney's powerfully successful revival. So this is up to you and me, that in our generation, we have the opportunity to decide whether or not we are going to let it pass by us, or we're going to experience it. You see, in one church like ours today, some people will get nothing of it. And some people will fall on their face and be refreshed, be refilled, and be transformed forever, and they will become powerful men and women of God. Up to you. Up to you. It's between you and the Holy Spirit. Next slide, Luke 24:49. And now I will send the Holy Spirit just as my Father promised, but stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven, or until you have been clothed with power from on high. And there is an emphatic I in this text over here when it says the and now I will, or behold, I myself, that's what it comes up with in Greek, just as my Father promised. This is a promise. And Jesus is very strong. He says, behold, surely now I will do it for you. And you will be clothed or endued. And the sense of, you know, in the time of Jesus, they were wearing robes, huh? It's like when you put your robe over your head and then it sinks over your body. It's like the Holy Spirit comes. This is the picture of that. Until you get clothed, until you sink, the Holy Spirit comes on you and sinks over you, and you are filled with the power from on high. This verse here, there is one evangelist, John Rice, who is speaking about it and says, the experience of the greatest soul winners that comes and church throughout church history verify the clear statements of Jesus Christ in both Acts 1:8 and Luke 24:49. When great men of God were filled with the Holy Spirit, they received power for soul winning and witness. And this is exactly what Jesus promised. This is the promise of the Father, and this is what is happening. There is in the next slide three statements from R.A. Torrey, that is a great revivalist, and this is how he described the purpose of the Holy Spirit. A definite experience, and a person knows when you receive it. So that's something that when you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, you know that you are baptized in the Holy Spirit. It's not the same as conversion or regeneration. Number two, it is a work of the Holy Spirit, distinct from and additional to his regeneration work. So again, this is reinforcing this fact. It is distinct, and it is different, and it is additional from the work of the Holy Spirit when we are born again. It's something more. It is a work of the Holy Spirit connected with and primarily for the purpose of testimony and service. And that is what Jesus said. You will receive power, and you will be my witness from here to the end of the world. So this is, the power is given to make a work in you, but it is to fulfill God's purpose that has never changed from generation to generation. Redeem, save, redeem, save. The work of the church, that is to equip the saints for the work of service, so that we can together from generation to generation be the body of Christ, the voice of the good news in this world, the reflections of God's power in our generation. D.L. Moody, that is also a very important person in terms of revival and reaching out to a large crowd of power. D.L. Moody, at one point in his life, had one of the biggest church in America, in Chicago, already. He says, I thought I had power. I had the largest congregation in Chicago, and I was, in a sense, satisfied. But there were two godly women in his church that were pushing him, that he needed to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And he did not really understand what they were talking about. But then he listened to them, and there came a great hunger in my soul. I did not know what it was. I began to cry out that God would fill me with the Holy Spirit. And well, one day in the city of New York, oh, what a day, I cannot describe it. It is almost too sacred an experience to name. Paul had an experience of which he never spoke for 14 years. So there's such an experience that we went through. I can only see that God revealed himself to me, and I had such an experience of his love that I had to ask him to stay his hand. I went to preach again. The sermons were no different. I did not present any new truths, and yet hundreds were converted just by this experience of the Holy Spirit. And he wrote an article on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and he says, in some sense and to some extent, the Holy Spirit dwells with every believer. You believe in Jesus, you receive the Holy Spirit. You are born again of the Spirit of God. But there is another gift, which may be called the gift of the Holy Spirit for service. That's how Moody called it, the gift of the Holy Spirit for service. This gift, it strikes me, is entirely distinct and separate from conversion and assurance. God has, listen to that, because it points to us today. God has many children that have no power. And the reason is they have not the gift of the Holy Spirit for service. God doesn't work with them. And I believe it is because they have not sought this gift. They have not searched for it. They have not asked for it. They have not coveted it. They have not felt that they needed it. So they just live their life. Paul says, now the lesson to be learned from this is that we must pray for the Holy Spirit for service. Pray that we may be anointed and qualified to do the work that God has for us to do. And then he gives an example of Elisha. And Elijah. Says, I believe that Elisha was a child of God before Elijah met him. He was already a servant of the Lord, knew of the Lord, but he was not qualified for the work of a prophet until the spirit of Elijah came upon him. So there's something that we need to be alert, wait upon, look for, search, pray for it, so that we will receive. We have to ask for this blessing. Keep on knocking for it. And if we have sin in our lives, if we have too many worldly ambitions and everything, it's like we are not empty vessels to be filled, right? So we need to prepare our hearts and to be able to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Amen? Hallelujah. All the men of God that we have mentioned this morning and many, many others have won more souls and preached with more power than any man who have lived since the Apostle Paul until now. The power of the Holy Spirit came upon them, changed their life, and they were people who brought reformation, they brought revivals, they led more people to the Lord than any other people since the Apostles. Pentecost is not only a wonderful day of the past. It is the promise of God's ongoing activity. And it is also an encouragement on how God can use us, can use me today, surely as he used Peter. Amen? Hallelujah. We can experience these things. You know, I was thinking about it when I read the article written by this pastor saying that in his church on their commitment Sunday they had experienced a Pentecost. And I've been thinking of what is happening in our church here. And I see many activities of the Holy Spirit already in our church. Many of that. Fruit of the Holy Spirit's activities in our church. And one of that strikes me because I've been talking quite a lot in the last few months to other pastors about what happened when we went to the Global Outreach Day last year. How spontaneous it was. We didn't have like clear plans and everything. All we had to do is join with the global community of Christians in the world and do something special in one weekend. So I look at it like one of our Pentecostal events and the sense of what God has done in our church. Look at the characteristic of what happened last year. There was, first of all, a super participation of the church beyond our expectation. We were probably 80% of the church in the park, which is, when I talk to other pastors in Hong Kong about that, they cannot believe it. Because usually when you do something and then you invite the congregation to participate, it's very hard to get like 10 people to move. And we were all in the park last year without dragging on, asking for it. I see the activities of the Holy Spirit. Look at the spirit of joy. We were sharing the gospel. We were in the park, and there was such a spirit of joy. And there was also the willingness and the ability to adapt, because we were not sure where we were going to do, what would happen. But no matter what, we're going to the park, and whatever happened, we are going to evangelize. We were united by the good news of the Lord. And there was a very good effect afterwards. There are also many other signs of the Holy Spirit activities in our church. There is a great commitment in this church in response to the many projects that we do here in the church, whether it is a Sunday school, the choir, or whatever it is, mission projects and everything. There are also many unselfish acts of service being accomplished week in, week out here. Willingness to help, cleaners, meet and greet, Sunday school, etc., etc. There is also a great commitment, it's kind of unique, I would say, a great commitment to Bible study. The Bible study is serious in this church, and we have seen it since we implanted the small group studies in the afternoon, the Friday night group, the Wednesday night group. The commitment to Bible study is very, very unique here in this church, and many times I hear it because we do it, we practice it, we don't realize it, but we hear it from people who visit our church, let's say from America. When they see what is happening here, they make comments to us about that. There is also new leaders emerging in our church, always willing to teach new classes, generation after generation, the newer welcome class, foundation class, small groups in the afternoon. And it is true also in the Philippines. And this week, I can tell you, we have experienced a night of Pentecost. A real, real thing was happening there in the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the crying on God and the searching for God. It was so awesome. There's a dedication to prayer, to worship in this church, and there is unity and mutual love, generosity. These are all activities of the Holy Spirit that are happening right now in our church. But is that all, or is there more? Is there growth in this one? When pastors preach on Pentecost, we hope to accomplish something, helping you to experience Pentecost as something that is happening today, not just long ago. So I invite Brother Stephen to take the guitar. I would like to sing that wonderful song that you taught us this morning, I Surrender. And in the last minute, we will close with just searching the Lord. As we have read, it's the gift of service, the power of the Holy Spirit. There are a few conditions for being